Welcome to L.P.J. 64. It is a beautiful morning, and I hope you got your Bible ready because we are ready to bring to you
the Word.
The Word. And we have ourselves a guest today here on L.P.J. And just to remind you what L.P.J. is.
It's love, peace, and joy. And on our show, Inspirations After Dark. So we thank you for joining us right here. So that we are going to be talking about how to recognize a true Christian. Just because we say that we are, that don't mean we are a Christian. So our guest right now is my sister, Angela. And she came all the way from California. So we thank you, Angela, for joining us.
Thank you so much for allowing me to be a guest on here. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Right. And she is a true woman of God.
Yes, she is. Amen.
A true woman of God. And we're going to have a great time for this half hour here. So let's get started. Let's get into this word.
So what's our first scripture we're going to?
I wanted to start with 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 5.
2 Timothy.
And so you are getting your Bible ready, I hope, and so you can see the will coming straight from the Word of God. We know you anything but the Bible. We like to read from the King James.
That's right.
I like using that because there is no other word that is more true than the King James. It seems to hit it right on the head.
2 Timothy, that's correct. What chapter?
That would be chapter 3, verse 5.
Okay. Do you want me to read it or you want to read it?
Go ahead, because I have other scriptures in front of me.
Okay, 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 5 says, having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, from such turn away. Wow.
Yeah.
The form. And so, you know, that's a good question about this form. Let's break that word down, form. The meaning of the word form.
That would be, from the dictionary, it says the visible shape or configuration of something.
Mm-hmm.
A particular way in which a thing exists or appears, a manifestation. So it's this outward look.
Mm.
But it's not really talking about what's on the inside.
That is correct.
And that's what I like about the scripture is because people can really get confused about what really is a Christian. Because that word right there gets thrown around so very much.
Mm-hmm.
And we can all think of somebody who seems like a Christian.
Right.
But there's no fruit.
There's
a form of godliness. Like they look godly. They may even dress godly. But when the things that come out of their mouth or the things that they do don't really line up with Scripture, and that's where we get into trouble.
Yeah, exactly right. That is very, very true.
That's very true. You know, you may go and you see the name on automobile. You're a Chevy man. It says Chevy. It looks like a Chevy. You say, that's my car. You get in that car, and you get the book out. This book is giving you instruction, and it says, Dodge. You see?
Exactly.
It looked like it was a Chevy.
Yeah.
It had Chevy written on it. And it looked nice like a Chevy. But when you got in there, wow. It fooled you.
It just had that form.
Yeah, it fooled you. It wasn't It wasn't a shit at all. Well, that's where we are about a look like Christian.
So in other words, you got a counterfeit.
You got a counterfeit. You got many people that walk around, they praise the Lord, they sing the song, they shout loud. But their heart is so far from being a Christian, being close to God, knowing God.
That's correct.
So they'll counterfeit.
Right.
God said in these times, there is so many counterfeits. See, know God, you must love, unconditional love.
Yes.
God said, I am love.
Yes, he is.
And so to know God, you must be able to love your enemy.
Amen.
Be able to love those that do not love you.
Yes.
Be able to love those that mistreat you.
Yeah.
Be able to feed those that would not give you a drink of water.
Wow.
That's God love.
Also, man, as you said that, you got another scripture?
Let's see here. I wanted to go to Luke.
Okay.
Chapter 5. And let's start with, because Jesus always spoke in parables, so I
yes,
love that.
Uh-huh.
I know as younger, the younger me may not have understood them all, but as you grow, you should grow in wisdom.
Amen.
And then God will show you what these things mean. So always, you know, with thy getting, all thy getting, get an understanding.
Amen.
That's what it works as.
That's how it works.
So I say, let's see, Luke chapter 5, verse, let's start at 36.
36?
Yeah, and we'll go to maybe about verse 39.
So in Luke chapter 5 and verse 36,
mm-hmm.
And he spake also a parable unto them. No man putteth a piece of a new garment upon an old, if otherwise, then both the new make it a rent, or basically that's tear. And the piece that was taken out of the new agreeth not with the old. And no man putteth new wine in old bottles, else the new wine will burst the bottles and be spilled, and the bottles should perish. But new wine must be put into new bottles, and both are preserved. Now may continue.
No, that's good. That's good. And basically, when we go to God and cry out to Him, wanting to be saved,
yes,
we may start out with all kind of mess. We may just not even be in our right mind. We may not be like so. No matter where God found us,
mm-hmm.
over time there should be a change.
Mm-hmm.
But He can't. He has to change our. He has to change us.
Amen.
So I like this wineskins scripture because He's not going to leave us the way we were.
Amen.
There is going to be a change. There will be a sacrifice. There will be a change.
Mm-hmm.
So we shouldn't be the same person that He met 10 years from now, 20 years from now. 30 years from now, 40 years from now, there should be a noticeable difference.
Noticeable, I like
in how
that.
We conduct ourselves, how we act, well, how we talk, you know, what activities we're involved in. There should be a noticeable difference. So it's totally new.
Amen. Amen. I like that because you said a noticeable difference. In other words, what the Lord is telling each of us as our heart. It's changed, it ought to come on the outside.
Yes, based on what He's doing on the inside.
Yeah, correct.
Well, you know, God is so amazing because look at life. He gives you a baby that's born from the mother.
Mm.
The first year, he looks different.
Mm.
And then the first 7 years, he's 7 years old.
Wow.
Then you put another new wineskin on him 7 years after that.
Yeah, he's a teenager.
He's 14.
Right.
And then you put another new wineskin on him 7 years after that. How old is he?
21. He's grown.
He's 21. You see the difference in the new wineskin?
He started changing his, the way he was when he was a baby, a toddler, a teenager, and became a man.
Yeah.
So he changed all his clothing.
Every 7 years.
Garment.
Is years of completion.
Amen. Amen.
And so when God finds you, he don't leave you where you're at.
Praise the Lord for that.
If you allow God to work in you,
that's right.
There will be a completion of new wineskin.
Amen.
But you must allow
him to work in you.
Him to work in you. And if he works in you, there will be a change that the world can see.
Yes.
You don't have to preach it.
Just live it.
You just live it.
Walk it out.
The world will see your walk, and they will see the difference in your walk.
Amen.
As so many of us want to preach what we do, and never live one step of our new life. God said, let your life speak
for you.
For you.
Give God and it gives God the glory.
And that's right. And it gives God the glory. But so many of us wants the glory ourselves. You want to take the glory from God. And let me tell you.
Wow.
God do not share his glory
with nobody.
With anyone. Amen. So that's why we are stuck in the darkness so long. That God has allowed the enemy to break us so we can call upon him and say, oh Lord, would you please raise me from this darkness and I will give myself to you.
We're in that wilderness moment.
All right.
We got one more scripture before we go and play a couple of songs.
Okay, so with that, which leads in actually to what we're talking about. So 2 Corinthians, my favorite.
Mine too.
Chapter 5, verse 17.
So in 2 Corinthians, chapter 5, in verse 17, that, you want to read it?
Okay. Read it. Therefore, if any man be in Christ,
okay,
he is a new creature.
Amen.
Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new.
Amen. Wow. There's your answer.
Right there.
So we become a new creation.
Yes.
Through Christ Jesus. You know, all the old things have passed away. So, in other words, every day is a die daily of our old self. But if we don't, then the old is going to still try to take over the new creation.
Yes.
Yes.
If we don't watch it.
Well, you see, when you put a new wineskin on, that means the old doesn't exist anymore.
That's correct.
So if you don't let the old man die, the new can't move in. The old must die and make room for the new, or the old will continue to live there.
In other words, what you're saying, when you go to put your clothes on, and will you continue to keep on the old clothes and put the new clothes on? Well, that's kind of what he's saying. Take those off and put on some new clothing. You don't continue to put on another pair of garments on top of the old ones.
That's right.
That don't make sense.
That's what he's saying. Are you going to wear new clothes on top of your old ones?
See,
That's exactly what he's saying. That's why you don't have Jesus when you put on new wineskin on top of old ones. We must drop the old in order for the new to be seen and be heard.
There you go.
You're not converted wearing the same old clothes.
That's right.
People recognize a new man when he changes and becomes new.
Wow.
And not look old trying to wear new clothes.
Wow.
When God works in you, then you'll be like Moses. It's a Moses. We know that you have been with Jesus. Your hair.
Yes.
Your skin. Mm-hmm. It glows. Your hair is silver. Then we all will be able to look at you and say, we know you know Jesus. You are a different person. You talk different. You walk different. You act different. We see the love of Jesus.
Amen.
You represent who you live for.
Right. Well, before we go on to a song, a couple of songs, you somehow converted. Now, what do we mean by converted or conversion? Well, that means the act or process of converting, the state of being converted, a change in character, form, or function. A change from one religion, political belief, viewpoint, to another. And thoroughgoing spiritual change that involves repentance and a turn towards God or right living.
Amen. And I'm glad you looked that up.
That's good.
I'm glad because a lot of people don't understand why their life haven't changed.
The character hasn't changed. Form hasn't changed. Your function.
Right.
Right living, repentance. Mm-hmm. And so all that makes a difference in recognizing a true Christian. Not just what I speak, but my form and everything else has to be in, what you call that, be in agreement, I say.
Yes.
In agreement, but what I speak, my form, what I live, what I talk has to be in the same agreement with what I say.
That's why we have to pray for God to change us. Mm-hmm. God has to touch your soul. He has to do this. He has to convert you, change you. Send the Holy Spirit to work in you and change you. This is not something you can do. That's the problem. A lot of us think we can change ourselves.
Right.
We go in thinking that we can change ourselves and come out thinking, well, we've been changed. And we come out just as dry as we did when because we haven't allowed the Lord to touch us. We haven't allowed the Lord to change us. See, it's a lifetime job. It doesn't happen
overnight
as we think it does. Right. We go in and get baptized and we come out and I am ready. Mm-mm. Well, Satan likes that. He loves it. Because he said, I've got you just where I want you.
That's it. That's correct.
Because now you're going to give up doing everything. You ain't going to pray like you used to. You ain't going to sing like you used to. You're not going to watch your mouth like you used to.
Because you think you've already arrived.
Yes. Okay. You ain't going to watch the people you hang with like you used to. You're going to do all the things you used to do. You're going to slack in them. And I've got you.
Wow. No, but before we go on, ahead and say one more, and then we'll go on to a couple of songs and come back. Yeah.
And you know what? You're not going to repent. And we'll be back up.
All right. So thank you for joining us right here on Inspiration After Dark. We're going to play a couple of songs right here on L.P.J. 64 where we're talking about how to recognize true Christians. Inspirations After Dark. So we thank you for joining us. We have been talking about how to recognize a true Christian. We have more scriptures. So my sister Angela, get ready to speak a little bit more about how to recognize a true Christian.
Hello. As one of the things that is interesting when you are being converted into that new creature that God describes is your belief system and the things that you do and say begin to change. It's a process. It's not an overnight destination.
Amen.
It's a journey. And what it is that you, where your identity used to be, you know, with the world believes that your identity lies in what you do, like your profession. The world believes that you are what you have. Your identity is resting in what you own, your car, your nice house, your purse, or whatever it is, your jewelry, your makeup. And another lie is the world says that you are what others think of you. And these are all idols to God. So it's basically changing your mindset from, and God is the one that's doing it. It's through prayer, it's through getting in His Word, it's communion, it's community.
Amen.
And God begins to take these ideas that the world has placed on you and begins to change that day by day by day by day, hour by hour. The more you're reading your word, the more you are fellowshipping with other believers, your mindset and the things that you used to care about begin to change.
Amen.
You know, you used to be, oh, maybe let's say you're a lawyer and you're wrapped up into all of that. You know, you're no longer thinking that, oh, I'm this great person because I am a lawyer. That steps down and you are thinking that, no, I am important because I am a child of God.
Amen.
And God, the things that you care about begin to change. You begin to look at your brothers and sisters around you and you want to help them. Instead of being selfish and thinking, what about me? You're thinking, what about them?
Amen.
What about others?
What about others?
And that's that love that God has and pours into us.
Yes.
And you begin, your outlook begins to change.
Amen.
And so I think one of the really, really good reminders, Proverbs, is Proverbs chapter 19. And it's verse 20.
I'm going to the old chapter here. Proverbs.
Chapter 19.
Okay.
I'll start with verse 20.
Okay.
And it says, hear counsel and receive instruction that thou mayest be wise in thy latter end.
Wow.
There are many devices in a man's heart. Nevertheless, counsel of the Lord, that shall stand.
Amen.
So that's verse 20 to 21. And it's basically taking all those desires and things that we're thinking about and giving that to the Lord so that He can put a stamp on that and change your desires. And I want to look at the word devices, because a lot of times we're reading the Bible and we will see words and it's important to look up what that means.
Amen.
Look up the word devices. And it says a thing made or adapted for a particular purpose, especially a piece of mechanical or electronic equipment. The second one says a plan, method, or trick with a particular aim. And the word is talking about there's many devices in a man's heart.
Yes, it is.
So there's many plans that we have, many methods of how to do it, and many tricks sometimes of how we're going to achieve what it is that we're trying to achieve.
Correct.
But if we take all of these things and go to the Lord, He may change and rewire something or just totally reroute some things that we're planning and say, hey, you know what, that's not what I have for you, my child. You know, I've seen the people of, they're going to school for this, Lord knocks on their heart, takes them in a whole new direction. And that's that new creation that's been
Amen.
Created. You know, the things we used to care about, like what people think and what I have
yeah.
and what I own and what I do in my profession, those things no longer matter. We may still use them as a way to glorify God. But those
that's
things
right.
are no longer the most important thing in our lives.
That's right.
Our most important thing is putting God first and asking, what will you have me do today, Lord?
Amen.
And making yourself available to what he's asking you to do and be obedient to that.
Oh, I like that because what is the true meaning of conversion? You just said something about obedience. Stated simply, true conversion is the fruit of faith, repentance, and consistent obedience.
Mm-hmm.
Faith comes by hearing the word of God and responding to it. You will receive from the Holy Ghost a confirming witness of the things you accept on faith by willing doing them.
Mm.
Wow. So consistent obedience. Not just obey today, but that's an everyday obedience in choosing to obey and surrendering your life to Christ each and every day. I like that.
That's true. That is very true. I mean, if you say you love God, why not obey?
He said, if you love me, keep my commandments.
That's right. You keep his commandments. And that's a way of showing the world that I serve the one that I love.
Amen.
I love him, so I obey him. That way, you set an example to the world. That I don't just say I love this God that I talk about.
I'm showing you.
I prove to you I
prove
because
you.
I obey. And this is what God wants me to do. Be an example to the world.
Mm-hmm.
That who you serve, that you believe in him, who you serve, you obey.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
See, we have to set this example, not just talk about it.
Right.
This is how we prove that God is who he says he is, because you prove it by being obedient.
That's correct.
And by serving someone that you obey, proves that he is who he says he is.
See, just like what you're saying, the question, so can you repent and not be converted? Listen to this. Repentance is conversion. Because, see, a repentant soul is a converted soul, and a converted soul is a repentant soul. So those, think about that. Because otherwise, if you are converted, you have already what? Repented.
Yes. Now, we're talking about true repentance.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
They say, can you repent and not be converted? No. Because if you're not converted, you're not going to repent anyway.
Right, you'll be full of pride.
There you go.
And we have a lot of that. A lot of people full of pride and they don't know.
And you never come to repent.
They never come to repent, true repentance. See, they're pride repenting. We have to look at all these different prides.
That's not true repentance.
That's why I said true repentance. See, you got to come to true repentance. And then
it makes a difference.
A lot of us think we have done true repentance, but we haven't. We're so full of pride that when we repent, pride knocks us right out of the box.
In other words, what the Lord is saying, a converted heart will have the true repentance. If a person say they repented, and then they're not showing those good fruits from a good tree, then they are not converted and they have not truly repented.
That's why we must be converted before anything. They go hand in hand. If you are truly converted,
you have truly repented.
These things will fall hand to hand. Mm-hmm. You know, God is decent in order.
That's it.
We have to do things decent in order.
Yes.
And when you do, things will fall in order and they will set them to.
That's right.
We have or have a jump in time, you know. We have had a jump in time trying to put this before that and that before this. This is why we come out with everything but the truth of anything. We must follow order. We must follow the way God has things already set up and not try to put things the way we think they ought to be. So we need to go spend time with God. Learn who God is. You can't be converted by someone you don't even know. Models don't know God. We don't spend time with them to know him. How can you be converted and you don't even know the one that's going to do that?
Wow. You don't even know him.
You don't even know him. So, a lot of us that think we're converted, you're not. You don't even know the one that's going to do that. You don't even know anything about it because you don't spend time reading. You don't spend time praying. You don't spend time talking. So how are you converted? You need to learn and become friends with the one that has that power to do that.
Yeah. So I got another question. What is the mark of a true Christian?
Let me hear. That sounds pretty good. What is it?
Well, the mark of a true Christian is the ability to love others unconditionally. Honor God. I'm going to go ahead.
Okay, go ahead. I got to hit me there.
No. We honor God when we operate in unconditional love, which is also called agape. Or the God kind of love. This type of love is not based on our emotions, but on a decision. Unconditional love never gives up on anyone. There it is.
See, now, right there, what I'm saying, and you ladies tell me if you agree. We don't even know God well enough to know about unconditional love.
Yeah, he has to really work on our hearts. And see, that's the work, that inner work that has to be done.
Yes.
You know, because we can't treat people the way we think that they deserve to be treated. No. We have to treat God. We have to treat God and treat others with
better
love.
Than we do ourselves.
You know, we can't act the same way. Like there was a person that you didn't like and they treated you well, you can't have all these comebacks.
That's right. That's right.
You may just have to love on them, pray for them, and follow what God wants you to do.
Amen.
You know, you can't flash on people.
Mm-hmm. That's
it. You know, that's that old man. That's going to be put away. And I love the fact that you were talking about repentance because, see, maybe you had a temper.
Yes.
And now you got to repent for that.
That's right.
And we make mistakes. Yes. You know, Christians are not perfect.
That's right.
The difference really between a Christian and a non-Christian is I know I'm broken. I know I'm a mess. I go to Jesus who can fix me.
There you go.
Whereas the person that's not a Christian, guess what? They don't know.
They're
full of pride. They don't know that they need help. They just go on their merry way. Whereas the person that's a Christian is like, no, I know I'm wrong.
Mm-hmm.
I know I need a Savior. I know I can't do this on my own. And I love how this definition talks about repentance. It says repentance is the act of acknowledging, because you want to acknowledge you're wrong.
That's right. That's
it's
it.
The act of acknowledging wrongdoing, expressing regret, and, because here's the key, and committing to change. Because if you don't change, it doesn't matter how many times you repent, if you keep going back to the same behavior, you haven't fully been converted, you haven't fully changed. And
that's
it's a gradual thing, but you got to make the first step to say, you know what, here I am, Lord.
Amen.
Help me with this because you're acknowledging your wrongdoing. You're coming with humility, and you know that God is the only one that can help you with
that's
that.
Right. That's
you know,
right.
He may have to give you step by step instructions, but we got to be still long enough to hear it.
Amen.
And then when we acknowledge our wrongdoing, we say, okay, Lord, help me to change. Because
that's
there's
right.
got to be some change. You can't keep doing the same thing
over
and
over
and expecting a new result. It just doesn't happen.
Yeah,
Amen.
See, that, and that's what I'm saying. We need to be converted. See, when we're not converted, we continue to keep doing the same thing over and over and say, oh, I know God. I know God. Jesus
right.
with me. I talk to God all the time. I pray to God all the time. But why are you committing the same thing
over
and over? And you're talking about you know God and you're converted, but you're doing the same sin over. You don't love.
Right.
You lie every time you get a chance. You open your mouth, you lie.
Right.
You are talking about people every time
right.
you get a chance. You help no one.
Mm.
You never lend a hand. You're always looking to be helped. But you say, I know God.
Mm.
We need, brothers and sisters, we need true what?
True conversion.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yes, we do.
And
we
God,
need it. Every day.
God is calling.
True repentance, true conversion.
God
yes.
is calling for a church that are ready to allow him to let the Holy Spirit
Amen.
Pour out true conversion.
As you
yes.
surrender to him
yes.
each and every day.
Right. He's ready for that. And he's looking for us that are willing to open our heart.
He's looking for a true church
That's
to
right.
worship him in spirit
and
in
truth.
All right.
He's calling for that church.
Amen.
And those that are willing to open their hearts up and let him in.
Amen.
He are willing to do just that. He's tired of us playing church.
Mm-hmm.
He's tired of us pretending that we know him.
Amen.
He's tired of us calling his name and wearing it out and getting nowhere with him.
Mm, right.
Because our hearts are so corrupt.
So desperately wicked, who can know it?
He wants a child that down on his knees and Father help me.
Amen.
I'm in bad condition, but I want to work for you, Lord. Please send your Holy Spirit to cleanse me.
Amen.
Wash me.
That's right.
That I may be fit to work for you, Lord.
Amen.
He's looking for a man that is willing to put his pride down and pick up the cross.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
Daily. That's right.
So
what you're saying is basically it's taking that time. And I love the scripture, Psalm 46:10. Be still and know that
I am God.
And that's a problem with a lot of people. We don't get still.
That's correct.
Get uncomfortable with our thoughts. We get wrapped up in the news and everything that's going on around us and distraction. And really, this generation and these people today that are living need to be still.
Amen.
Because it's not just getting as well. We got to hear what God is telling us.
Yeah, we got
to
hear it.
We got to hear and we have to obey. Like
Amen.
You spoke on being obedient.
Yes.
And that's the difference between a non-believer, a person that says they're a Christian, versus a person that really is. Because a person that's a Christian is going to be still.
That's right.
That's it.
And they're going to pray, but they're also going to listen.
Yes. Amen.
You can't be still and not listen.
That's right.
Well,
very
what,
true.
What good is it to be still?
And you're not going to obey.
Not going
to listen. And did he say, and his word, disobedience is like witchcraft?
It is witchcraft. It is witchcraft. You might as well go on out there and put a spell on somebody.
Yeah, because that's what it is.
You said that's what it is. If you're not going to obey, you are a witch compared to God.
Yeah.
He said if you go disobey, then you're nothing but a witch. So we need to take God at his word.
That's right.
And pray that God will help us overcome our disobedience to his word.
Amen.
Because this is why a lot of our prayers
are hindered.
This is why God don't hear us when we ask. This is why we don't receive a lot of things that we ask for. Because we do not obey.
That's right. There you go. So we thank you so much for joining us on this topic today on how to recognize a true Christian. Remember, stay in your word, stay in prayer, and number one is to love unconditionally. Mm-hmm. And that's what we all have a battle with. But only through Christ we are able to do that.
And Angie, what is your good nugget for today?
Oh, the nugget for today is may the windows of heaven open and pour upon you a bundle of lessons. Have a wonderful and blessed day. Stay encouraged and be blessed.
I want to know, Angie, I know you got a good nugget.
Thank you, Gene. That's really, really good. I just wanted to say, I wrote this little spoken word. It says, I'm not just a teacher. I am a child of God.
Amen.
Not measured by this world's ruler or rod. I am not just what I drive or what I work or where I wear or where I go to work. Whether it's, and I'm not just what I have labeled on me. It's not whether I have a dress or a skirt.
Amen.
I am a child of God. So remember that it's all about following His leadership and His will for our life, not just our own.
Amen.
Amen. No. Go ahead.
Go ahead.
So my little nugget for today, bless someone today.
Yes.
Do not miss your blessing because of your pride. Will not allow you to bless someone else.
Amen. And have a wonderful and blessed afternoon.
Take me to the King. Take me to the King.